Welcome back to another video. It is your favorite math professor, Dr. Tarsia Hubert. In this video, we are going to be looking at bias in sampling. Yes, we've been talking about how to collect the sample and the way you pick your samples can determine biasness in your study. And so, what exactly is bias? Bias is when the results of the sample are not representative of the population. So, for example, a study is conducted to determine if a weight loss program is successful for those with diabetes. But if the study focuses completely on the participants who complete the program, then the results may be biased, okay? So let's think about that for a minute. If the results only talk about those who completed the program, then the results may be more favorable because you're not considering those who dropped out of the program. And those who drop out are usually those who cannot stick with the weight loss program for whatever reason. And those who stay are those who are most likely the ones that are seeing success and are losing weight. And so, in the end, if you only focus on those who complete the program, then your results are going to be more favorable, which means you have biased results. The sample is not representative of the population. Alrighty? That's an example of biasness. There are different sources of bias. There are many sources of bias. If you do a Google search of source of bias or reasons for bias in research, you'll see many different types of examples. But we're only going to talk about three in this video. And the first one is sampling bias. And we're going to talk more about what that is in a little bit. Non-response bias and response bias. We're going to focus on those three types of bias, starting with sampling bias. The technique used to obtain the individuals in the sample tends to favor one part of the population over another. Whenever this happens, we have sampling bias, okay? So, for example, if you ask a group of ninth graders what they believe the speed limit should be, this is definitely sampling bias because, first of all, you're asking ninth graders who most likely aren't even driving yet. And so you have overrepresentation of those who probably don't even have driver's license and an underrepresentation of those who are actually on the roads driving. So you're asking the wrong people here, so you have a sampling bias. All convenience samples have sampling bias. So remember, convenience samples are those samples that you take because they're easy to take. So anytime you sample people because they're easy to take or they self-select, they voluntarily participate, you have sampling bias. So usually when people volunteer, they have strong opinions about something, and therefore that's where that sampling bias comes from. Undercoverage occurs when the proportion of one segment of the population is lower in a sample than it is in the population. So for example, say a college is one college has a population that is majority female. But they want to survey students and they take a sample, and in this sample, it's mainly males. So, in that case, we have undercoverage of our females, which is usually the majority of the population. All right, so that's an example of undercoverage. Undercoverage can occur if the frame is incomplete. Remember, the frame is the list of all the people in the population. If you don't have a complete frame, then you don't have a complete picture of what your population looks like. And so, therefore, it can result in undercoverage. And sampling bias, most of the time, leads to inaccurate or incorrect predictions. The next type of bias we're going to talk about is non-response bias. This occurs when individuals selected to be in the sample who do not respond to the survey have different opinions than those who do. Basically, when individuals don't respond or the interviewer can't contact them, then you have non-response bias. I get these all the time. You get those surveys after you've visited somewhere or you've had a call with somebody and they send you these surveys and you just don't participate. Well, a lot of those surveys end up with non-response bias. Typically, the ones who participate are the ones who have really strong feelings about what happened. They were dissatisfied or they were extremely satisfied. So, for example, suppose you're researching workload among managers in a supermarket chain. You decide to collect your data via a survey. Chances are here you're going to end up with non-response bias. If you're measuring the workload among managers, managers are typically really busy. So the ones who are really busy, and have a huge workload, most likely they are not going to respond. You're probably going to end up with the managers who have a lower workload responding, which is going to bias your results because their workload is lighter. So you want to be careful of how you select your sample so that you won't end up with non-response bias. So methods for dealing with non-response bias include doing callbacks. So if you get people who don't respond, following up with them, calling them back, or now emailing or text messaging them back. That's one way for dealing with non-response. And another way is using rewards or incentives. So I talked about Chick-fil-A earlier in a previous video. Chick-fil-A, when they want you to fill out their surveys, they'll give you a free Chick-fil-A sandwich for doing it. That's an example of using a reward to get people to respond. And then the third type of bias is response bias. This exists when the answers on the survey does not reflect the true feelings of the respondent. Now, this could be due to a number of things, including interviewer error. So it's really important who you use to interview participants if it's not just like a written survey. Interviewers should be experienced. Some interviewers can make people feel comfortable. Some interviewers can be intimidating. And if people don't feel comfortable and feel intimidated, they may not actually tell the full truths. So interviewer error can happen. Misrepresented answers can happen. The answers might be exaggerated, basically. If you ask people how much money they make, they might exaggerate. Or if you ask them, their ability to do something such as push-ups or jumping jacks, in their head, they might could do a lot, but in actuality, they may not be able to. So you might have misrepresented answers. The wording of questions. I think about this all the time when I go vote. Whenever you vote and there are propositions on the ballot, the way they are wording can be so confusing. I have to read those 4 and 5 times to make sure I'm understanding it right. So the way things are worded can cause biasness. The ordering of questions. So if you have questions in a specific order, that could change your people's responses as well. The type of question. You have open-ended questions and closed-ended questions, and the type of questions that you have can also create biasness. And then data entry error. So a lot of times when people do things on paper, someone has to go when they fill out surveys and questionnaires on paper, someone has to go back and take those answers and input them into the system so that they can be analyzed. Well, sometimes the people entering the data make errors, which can change your answers and misrepresent your data. So these all cause response bias. So we're going to look at some examples and identify the type of bias in the next few examples. So the first example is a retail store manager wants to conduct a study regarding the shopping habits of his customers. He selects the first 60 customers who enter the store on a Saturday morning. What type of bias do we have here? If you said sampling bias, you are correct. So what is wrong with this? He's selecting the first 60 customers who enter in the morning. These are morning customers, people who shop in the morning. So it's not going to give you a good representative of your population or good representation of your population because you have people who shop all throughout the day. People who shop in the morning are probably they probably have pretty similar shopping habits. You want to spread it out and get people who shop in the afternoon, people who shop in the evening, people who shop at night. Next example, Cold Stone Creamery is considering opening a new store in Spring Hill. Before opening the store, the company wants to know the percentage of households in Spring Hill that regularly visit an ice cream shop. The market researcher obtains a list of households in Spring Hill, randomly selects 200 from the list, and makes a questionnaire that asks about ice cream eating habits and flavor preferences. Of the 200 questionnaires mailed, 5 are returned. So they only get a survey from 5 people. What kind of bias do we have here? Yeah, this one is so evident. It's non-response bias. So they didn't get enough responses to be able to get a good idea of what the eating ice cream preferences are, ice cream eating habits and preferences are for the people in that community. Some of the things they could do here is find a different way to sample or survey the people. They could get people who randomly select people in the community, or they can get people who shop at certain ice cream places or just different things. They want to reconsider how they are collecting their information. Next example, suppose you are conducting a survey regarding the sleeping habits of students. From a list of registered students, you obtain a simple random sample of 250 students. One survey question is, how much sleep do you get? What kind of bias is present here? Or could be present? Response bias. Now, why is response bias an issue here? The wording of the question is the issue here. How much sleep do you get? That question is ambiguous. It needs to be more specific. So one thing you could do is ask, how many hours of sleep do you get per night? And then you'll get more specific answers. But if you have an ambiguous question like that, your questions are going to be all, your answers are going to be all over the place. So you're going to have some response bias here. For instance, how much sleep do you get? Somebody might say enough, or I don't know, or but if you ask them more specifically, how many hours of sleep do you get each night? Then that causes people to think and give a number for the hours of sleep, and you get more, your answers are more concise. So those are some examples of some situations that involve our three types of biasness. And then the last two things we want to talk about are sampling errors and non-sampling errors. So sampling errors, just like it sounds, these are errors that occur because of how you chose your sample. It results from using a sample to estimate information about a population. And then non-sampling errors results from undercoverage, non-response bias, response bias, or data entry error. Alrighty, so these are two different types of errors that you can get or that you might hear being discussed when talking about research. And so these are your different types of biases. Again, there are many other types of bias that you may have, but the three that we focused on in this video are sampling bias, response bias, and non-response bias. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to reach out with the questions, and I will see you all in the next video.